Ladies and gentlemen, from the soulful Memphis, Tennessee, live from mycymbal.com and Memphis Drum Shop, give a warm welcome, Mr. Steve Jordan.
Going on? Everything cool? It's a real pleasure to be down here in Memphis. I'm making a Boss Gags record down here at the legendary Royal Studios and with a cast of legends. And I'm really fortunate to come and visit this incredible drum shop. You know, Jim Pettit has this amazing store and he's dedicated himself to having basically one of the largest inventories I've ever seen in a drum store. And his love for drums and drumming is, you know, there are only like a handful of people in the world that dedicate themselves to the craft. So I'm very fortunate to pay a visit down here. And I go around this shop and I see all these amazing drums and I freak out and I don't know what to do. It's like a kid in a candy store. And I said, hey, what can I do? Can I come down and hang out? And he said, sure. You want to take some questions from around the world? I said, absolutely. So that's what I'm here to do. So if anybody out there has any questions about anything, whether it's playing, what I played on you know, records or anything about production or songwriting or just life in general, shoot away. Take a shot. Take your best shot.
You want a question now?
Absolutely.
Here's one from Billy Harrington, Ann Arbor, Michigan. He says you're about to MD the Emmys this year?
Absolutely, and I know Billy, so how you doing, Billy? How's it going? Billy's a Wolverine.
Ah.
Yeah. I met him and his crew out there in Michigan a couple of years back.
And he wants to know, like, what are your responsibilities with a show like this, and how long a process is it, you know, from the planning to the final dress rehearsal?
Well, this is my third Emmys. And the first time I did it, it was a very a nerve-wracking experience. It's wall-to-wall music for 3 hours. And there's a lot of different types of music. I have the privilege of working with the legendary Don Mischer and the people at Don Mischer Productions. And they wanted to bring something a little different than the traditional way they had done the shows. And I'd worked with Don on the 2004 Democratic National Convention and Kennedy Center Honors and Movies Rock and Fashion Rocks. So I said, sure, I'll do this. And I had no idea what I was getting into. Not only do you have to become familiar with all the music, the different music from all the different shows, but I was also asked to entertain the audience during commercial breaks and then also write original material for bumpers. Bumpers are the music going into commercials and coming out of commercials. So there was a lot of music, and luckily I was able to hire a very good friend of mine to be associate MD with me to go after this So I was lucky enough to enlist the great David Page. And David and I put together a way of doing this where we could knock out the music efficiently and still have it be a pleasurable experience. I have a legendary band, Michael Bearden on keyboards, Ray Parker Jr., Dean Parks, Darryl Jones, Tom Scott, George Bohannon, just to name a few. It's really pretty remarkable. I have the privilege of also hiring a lot of great arrangers. So if I see, well, this person would be really great to arrange this piece of music, I have the luxury of calling them and say, look, I have some music for you to arrange, and that gets worked out. So after I did the first one, there was so much music involved that the second year I did it, which was the following year, a lot of the same shows are nominated. So I had half the amount of work, and that was really good. So that made the job. After you do the first one, you have to do the second one, because it's like, if you don't, you're an idiot, you know? So this is my third one. Then there was a break in between. It was the first and second year I did it, and then they went with another producer for the third year because Don Mischer was working on some 9/11 10-year anniversary thing. So we didn't do it the third year, so now we're back. So, and not all the same shows, but some shows are the same, like Mad Men and stuff like that. So, it takes a lot of work, but I have a really good team. Michael Beard and David Page, Stefan Norden, Ryan Jeffrey Paulson, and of course I can call Dean Parks or Tom Scott in addition to do some other arranging work along with Brad Dechter and Tom Rainier, and you know, it's just it's all first class. What I do is I basically hire a band of producers or musical directors, so you can't go wrong, basically.
Okay, Steve, we got a question here from Lee Yat Ding, mm-hmm. Hong Kong.
Wow.
And he wants to know, how do you practice being in the deepest pocket? When you do specific time feels, such as behind the beat or on top of the beat, and what should be the relationship between a good groove to a click? I am being taught to make the click sound musical, but it's all a bit too abstract to me.
Well, that's a really great question, and it's also, he's right about it being pretty abstract. First of all, the click, you'll never make the click sound musical. That's number one. You have to sound musical with the click. Now, as I say in my DVD, there's a lot of distance between two quarter notes. And depending on what the music says and what the song says, there's all that room to play with. Now, most drummers, since they're striking the instrument, because it's a percussion instrument, they don't really know the full length of the quarter note because they're just hitting it, but they're not stopping the drum. When I was playing timpani, obviously, you have to start and stop the note, and that's when you really know the full length of a quarter note, depending on, obviously, the tempo, so on and so forth. So that's one way of getting familiar with the length of a quarter note and where to place the beat. Also, when I started playing bass, that also helped. And then you start to develop your relationship with other musicians and where they feel time, and especially with bass players. If we want to just talk about bass players, there are certain bass players who, whatever instrument they would play, they feel it in certain ways. They feel stuff on the top of the beat. Some people are very precise and hit right in the middle of the beat no matter what. So you have to figure all that out. The thing that I like to do is I like to make I play a song, so I don't preconceive how a beat or the music should be played. I let the song dictate to me what I should play. So for instance, if I'm playing something in a hip hop nature, sometimes that's on top of the beat. Everything is like a kind of like upbeat kind of, you know, status. But then if I'm playing, this might be, even though I'm playing 16th notes, I'm like laying the snare drum back, and that's a different kind of pulse. It could be the same tempo, but I can find, you know, all different ways to place the beat within those two quarter notes. That would be better demonstrated if I had a click going, and then I could show you just how many different ways you can play around the click. But basically, you have to let the song dictate to you where to place the beat. Also, depending on who you're working with and what you're doing, the producer or the artist or whatever may have something in mind, the way they'd like to hear it. When I was a younger player, I used to always try to, you know, because you're trying to build confidence, you're always said, well, I think it should be here. And you go in with that kind of thing. Yeah, well, I'm going to play it like this. And the guy's like, hey, you know, you might want to play it like that, but it really should go like this. And so the more you play and the more situations you're involved in, you realize you get your priorities together and you see what you're supposed to do professionally and how to still feel like you're putting yourself into the music and yet helping the artist and the producer achieve their goal.
Great, Steve. This is from Alex from the Netherlands. What exercise do you perform before playing a gig or recording?
I don't do any exercises. Now, if you mean drum exercises, I try to do some yoga to keep limber, but I don't really. I mean, the most I do sometimes to get my hands warm, I'll just do some paradiddles or something that I was taught by the great Freddie Waits when he showed me how to play match grip. He used to do this exercise, this triplet thing, this, and then try to do it as fast as possible. Of course, I can't really do it. He used to do it at blazing speed. I don't know how he did it, but so that's one kind of thing just to get that helped with being ambidextrous. That was a very ambidextrous type of exercise. But I just try to do paradiddles and double paradiddles just to get warm when I'm playing live. When I'm in the studio, I don't do any kind of exercises just because it's not really about that. It's about the sound. It's about my exercise is getting the right sound for the song that I'm about to play and what the producer wants, or if I'm producing, what I think the song needs. Like that.
Yeah, so how much do you get into? You get into character, in other words.
Yeah, absolutely. When I'm producing, the main thing is how can I best showcase the artist, and then what is the right sound for the music? What makes a record? When I was growing up, there were things that you always heard on a record, because I'm a record lover. I've been listening to recordings ever since I was 2 years old. So what were the things that came out in a record? Well, one of the first things you heard on every record, and records, pop records, let me qualify, pop records, were built on this. A couple of elements always came out. The vocal sound and the snare drum sound. The snare drum sound and the vocal sound. Those were the priorities. And that's what made the sound of a record. You could, you know, when a beat came and started, well, you knew what record it was. And there was always great care taken about, well, what how, what was going to be the backbeat. Was it going to be two snare drums? Was it going to be a snare drum and a tambourine? Was it going to be a clave and a tambourine? There's always great care taken in the approach to what the backbeat of a record is going to sound like, because that is your hook. You're looking for different hooks. Besides the melodic hook, you're looking for the hook that's going to catch the person who's listening to go, wow, that's a cool sound, and man, that groove is happening. And so that's it. So that's how I approach.
Okay, speaking of grooves, this is from Atlanta Drum Guy. Can you demonstrate a couple of grooves from your David Sanborn recordings?
Oh, that's funny. Okay, sure. It's funny, Lanny McMillan, who's a great tenor saxophone player down here in Memphis, played a lot of stuff with the East Memphis Horns and then later with the Memphis Horns, and worked a lot with the legendary Willie Mitchell. We were doing a horn session yesterday with the likes of Jack Hale and the legendary Ben Cawley and also the legendary Jim Horn. And Lanny was talking about, man, I just bought up front Dave Sanborn, and boy, that was a hot record, man. And he mentioned Snakes. And so it's funny, I was just playing his groove yesterday. The very wonderful Marcus Miller, who produced the record, wrote this tune, and one of my favorite tracks that I've ever played on, and just a wonderful, wonderful recording.
Dominic March from Brisbane, Australia. How and why did you end up with your combination of 17-inch crashes as your hats?
Well, a couple of reasons. I always liked the sound. There was a certain point where I was tired of the conventional hi-hat cymbal sound. So much so that when I recorded with Aretha Franklin and Keith Richards for the remake of Jumpin' Jack Flash that Aretha did, that appeared in that Whoopi Goldberg movie, I didn't even play the hi-hat. I played this thing called the Crasher, which was like strips of metal on top of each other. And I was just off of the hi-hat, you know? And it's like eating a certain food over too many years. And then it's just like, enough. The hi-hat is a wonderful invention. When you record, you see that the hi-hat, when you're trying to blend the drums, the hi-hat gets in everywhere. You know, it gets in every mic, it gets everywhere, you know, whatever. So it's sometimes hard to contain, and it can dominate a record depending on how you lay into it and stuff. And I was just over it. And I got into the crasher thing for a while, and then I thought, okay, I need to find another thing. And I started playing with different combinations. I started out with 15s and started playing 15s on Letterman. And I was working with Charlie Drayton during that period of time. And Charlie was also experimenting with bigger cymbals as well. So we were messing around with different sizes. And then I saw some footage of the drummer for Creedence Clearwater Revival, which is, you know, one of my favorite bands, one of the greatest bands of all time. And he was using things, they looked like 20-inch cymbals. I mean, they were huge, and I was, whoa. And I just loved that groove, man. You know, Green River is one of the greatest records ever made. that whole, and I thought, wow, that's, I want to go there. And what I discovered was, or what I found out, I didn't discover anything. Obviously, it was discovered before I got a hold of it, but the pitch comes down on it because they're bigger cymbals, so the pitch is down. So then it blends in better with the drums. So it's not everywhere. And depending on how you play, depending on the thickness of the cymbals, it really blends really well with the other cymbals, and it gives you another color that you don't normally have. And then I fell in love with it, because then I could lay into it, and it didn't dominate the track. You could give it some juice, and it wasn't everywhere. It didn't get in every mic and everything. It blended well with the drums. It gave you another color.
And, big sound.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's really wonderful.
Well, speaking of big, here's a question from Odin from Norway.
Okay.
Greetings from Norway. Ask Steve Jordan if he ever considered using bigger hi-hats. I have his signature hi-hats myself, but would love to try like a 19 or a 20.
Well, there you have it. Well, so, and I'll be going home tonight and playing with some 20-inch cymbals. Now, I think, see, 20 might be too big, but then you never know. I mean, for certain tunes, you never know. That's the whole beauty of recording and just playing. That you, when you're a musician, you can do anything. You know, I mean, 32-inch hi-hats, what the heck? Sometimes what I found out before, Peisty was kind enough to indulge me in getting some cymbals, a set of hi-hats made. Sometimes with the two, because I like the thin cymbals, sometimes when I'm laying into it, what I would find out if I was playing like bebop, for instance, or just playing some funk, high octane funk, that the bottom cymbal would, just kind of invert because the cymbal was so light.
Yeah.
So when I'm going like that, so we had to work on that. So we use a little heavier bottom sometimes, just a hair bottom. So that the thing didn't just flip open. Many a time I was on a gig and all of a sudden I'd hear that sound, fucking! And then all of a sudden, you know. Now also, playing. See now, when I'm playing bebop, like say for instance, when I was playing with Sonny Rollins, that sound is just—it's like it's bebop's version of a backbeat, you know. So if you don't hear that, for some players, they want to know where the beat is. Of course, Tony Williams kind of flipped the script on that when he started playing, where he didn't do that anymore. He kind of changed the whole approach, and it's funny because he was more like this. That kind of thing. So he was moving it around and doing all kinds of stuff and playing threes against two. I mean, he was, you know, genius, Tony Williams. But sometimes you don't hear it with the big hi-hats. You don't hear that sock sound. But what I do like about playing bebop with the big cymbals is that you can use it for a ride. Another thing, which you don't really do with the smaller hi-hat because it's too annoying. But with the bigger things, you know, you can really get into something. So, you know, you can really mess around and stuff with the, you know, so it really depends on who you're playing and what your approach is.
Okay, Mitch Lyons from Macon, Georgia. What would you recommend that I do to become more adaptive to any situation in music? Basically, how could I build up my versatility if there's not a diversity of musicians where I live, you know, and play with?
Well, that's a good question, and here's what I'd do. I would listen to as much stuff as possible. When I was growing up, I would listen to everything, and I would try to get inside a person's head and soul if I thought it would help me understand certain ways of playing in different types of music. For instance, when I was coming out of the fusion type playing, because I did play a lot of that when I was younger, first starting out, I said, well, how do I get into something that will tone my playing down to where I could, you know, play some rock and roll that wasn't too busy and stuff like that. Now, this is before I realized who the classic players were. Like, in other words, I was always a huge, you know, Ringo Starr, Richard Starkey is like probably my favorite drummer, or the top three of my favorite drummers, whatever, you know, with Al Jackson, Benny Benjamin and stuff, Fred Bilo, that kind of thing. But, and Tony, of course. But I'd start listening to other players that weren't so well known. Just because they were playing with certain artists and they were making these hit records, and the records sounded great, and they weren't super famous or like didn't have like tremendous chops or anything. It wasn't about that, you know. It was about these records that felt a certain way. A lot of the time that has to do with a band feeling. That's why I love bands, you know. So I was listening to Steve Miller Band, and the drummer was playing with that, and I liked, you know, the Steve Miller album that had Swing Town on it and stuff like that. That was one of my favorite records at the time. And then I got into listening to Billy Joel, and then what Liberty DeVito was playing with Billy Joel, which was, you know, who knew Liberty DeVito, you know? But the way he played with Billy Joel was really special. The way Pick Withers played in Dire Straits, I love that. And when I ended up playing in Dire Straits for about 10 days, I played on Local Hero with Mark Knopfler. I really, first of all, I didn't understand why Pick Withers wasn't in the band anymore. I didn't get it, because, you know, that's one of those things where I don't think people realize, not even band members or leaders of bands realize, when you have a chemistry, the drummer is part of that chemistry. And when you can't just replace a drummer and expect the band to sound the same. It just doesn't happen. I mean, for me, AC/DC didn't sound like AC/DC until Phil Rudd got back into AC/DC. You know, that's all there is to it. I think Stan Lynch's contribution to Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers is underestimated, unsung. You know, I think that, you know, that kind of thing. So I was always just listening to different players, no matter what their stature was. I was listening to how the band reacted, how it sounded, what the record sounded like. That touched people, you know. And didn't get into, well, the person wasn't flash enough or whatever, you know. It wasn't like that, you know. And that dictated a lot of stuff. Also, when I started hanging out in the studio scene as a kid, just, you know, people would say, hey, you want to come by a session? And I'd just watch. I could never get enough of being in the studio, just watching other players. And I saw players that nobody's ever heard of that made a lot of records, especially during the disco era. Drummers like Jimmy Young. Who knows Jimmy Young? They know Earl Young from Philadelphia. They know Jimmy Young, a New York disco drummer. It was fantastic. He could play that four on the floor and do that thing, and he had a sound, you know. And I learned a lot. You know, there's a good friend of mine named Leo Adamian, who had a great sound when I was coming up, and I was trying to navigate how to get a groove and what the sound contributed, how sound contributed to the overall picture. And this guy had a sound, he sounded like he was in a studio on a live show, you know. I said, well, how do you do it? How are you tuning your drums? What kind of thing, you know? So it was like that, you know, just trying to listen to as many different types of music as possible. If something strikes your fancy that you like, try to seek out more of it.
Steve, you know, it's interesting. I hear you keep using two words over and over, sound and music.
Right.
And those are two good words. And
yeah, yeah, exactly.
I think they have a lot to do with what you do.
It's a good movie, sound of music. Yeah.
Well, you know, we were lucky. We just had the Jeff Hamilton Trio here last week, and we did a similar live My Simple Session. And the words music and sound came up a lot. And Jeff brought up an idea or a thought that I hadn't heard of a lot. But he said, you know, you talk about sound. Drummers, how do you start off practicing? On a rubber pad. You know, a dead rubber pad. And that's the way you practice. How do horn players, how do guitar players start? They get their sound first.
Right. Yeah.
So
we're at a disadvantage.
Yeah.
You know, it's funny. Well, you know the story, Jim, because I told you. But the first, you know, one of the first experiences I had with that type of thing was my mom took me to a private music school. There was a store in our neighborhood, and it was really amazing. Gretsch instruments and all over, hanging off of walls all over the place, you know, all kinds of stuff. And it was like, wow, this is amazing. This is an incredible place. So I meet the teacher. His name is Joey Cowell. He's a great person, became a mentor for a while there. And he sits me down behind a set of drums. And they were Blue Sparkle Gretsch drums. I'll never forget it. I'm sitting behind the drums, they sit me behind there. I'm looking at the mechanisms, the hi-hat, the whole thing. I'm going, and he said, okay, are you gonna do everything possible are you gonna practice? I said, yes. Are you gonna put in the time and the effort it takes to do this so you're not wasting your parents' money? And everything? Yes. Everything, okay, because we're not, you know, they weren't gonna get me a drum or anything until I took lessons and everything. So, okay, great. So, yeah, you know, I'm gonna do everything that it takes. And then I said, okay, we'll start next week. And I go home, and every night until the next Monday, I'm dreaming about playing the drums. I cannot wait for this week. This week cannot go by any faster. And I get back, and school is over, and now I'm rushing off to my first drum lesson. And Joey meets me, he says, okay, come in, kid. And I go in the same room with these beautiful drums were, and I walk in and there are two slabs of rubber and a seat and no drums in sight. And I was crushed. It was a cruel joke, but that's what it took. It's okay, you're gonna have to start here before you get to those. So needless to say, I practiced and, you know, got my reading together and everything and my technique and all that kind of stuff. But yes, you're right. We don't approach sound until a lot later on in the process, where people are learning how to get a tone from the very beginning. You can't play a violin just going the whole time. You know, it just doesn't work. You got to get a tone.
Right.
And you know, yeah. So yeah, we're definitely at a disadvantage for sure.
Okay. Here's a question from Brady Bunch in New York. He's a Symbolholic.com member, looks like. He says, ask Steve how you can play a strong backbeat with a traditional grip all night long, such as I've seen you do with John Mayer, with such small sticks without hurting your hands, or how do you get that sound?
Well, first of all, I don't play traditional all night long. It's impossible for me to do. But this is what Freddie Waits taught me. Freddie Waits taught me about matched grip. So in a jazz sense, see, because that's that kind of playing is always thought of it in a traditional sense, but he played match. So when I saw that, I said, okay, you can do that. Now, I also looked at some other players, like the great Al Jackson. He would play match grip. And when you play match grip, well, you get a different sound in the backbeat. So if I'm playing like this, that sounds different than I have to do different things. You know, if I want to do like a Motown, you know, kind of a Uriel Jones, Pistol Allen, Benny Benjamin thing, kind of a traditional thing. You're hitting in the center of the drum. You're trying to get a tone out of the drum. But then if you, sometimes you got to turn the stick over. Gives you a different sound. So during a show and during a song, depending on how I'm feeling, I'm going back and forth. Sometimes I'm turning it over for the chorus and then I come back for a verse. You know, it really depends. Like I said, the music dictates.
You mix it up. Cool. This is another cymbalholic question from Spain. I'll have to spell this because I can't say it. TXALAPARTALARI.
Okay, cool. Well, I lost you halfway through, so.
But they want to know, ask Steve about his influences, and I know you've already mentioned a lot, but ask him about his influences and his drumming heroes. And I'd also like to ask Steve, how does he get such a nice sense of groove? But I suspect that that answer is practice, practice, and daily practice.
Well, it's practice, but it's also getting in touch with trusting your instincts. And that's a kind of a holistic kind of approach. If you're not feeling good about things in general, confidence, there's a certain amount of confidence it takes to actually play at a certain level. For instance, yesterday, I'm cutting this track with Boss Skaggs, and basically Boss is playing guitar, Willie Weeks on bass, Spooner Ullman on keyboards, and we're cutting a blues tune called Dry Spell. And it's a shuffle. Now, there are a million different types of shuffles. Most drummers can play only one type of shuffle, and really well, but it's usually where they live. But there are lots of different types of shuffles, and depending on what part of the world you're from, you kind of specialize in that type of shuffle. You know, you can play. And the list goes on and on. There's the Texas shuffle. You know, there's all kinds of stuff. But in Chicago, the Jimmy Reed records, if you listen, they're very, first of all, the sound isn't that big. It's small. There's almost like a primitive approach to the record making in a. Now that's kind of a thing where it's so elementary and so primitive. You're like, it almost sounds like I don't know how to play. And but it's a commitment to that sound and that feel, because if that's the only type of shuffle to play with the tune that we were recording. So I'm playing this thing. It's almost like the beat that was on Take Out Some Insurance on Me Baby, Jimmy Reed. And it's like, it's really, as I said, kind of primitive. So much so that when I'm playing it, I don't even know how it's happening. And like in the middle of the take, I almost have an anxiety attack knowing that the thing sounded so good, but I didn't know what I was doing. And it was so much so that I was like, you know, praying to get through the track because I knew it was a good record. That kind of stuff you don't really practice. You have to feel like I had to rein myself in to get through the track. And these things happen. You're never above being like nervous. I remember times playing a shuffle, like a real high octane shuffle with Clapton, you know, and there, you know, thousands of people out there. And then right in the middle of the thing, I'm going, holy cow, whoa, how am I doing all this? Whoa, I better not think about that. This is going to derail because, you know, a drummer, all we have to do is miss one beat and the whole house is a house of cards, you know. Man, guitar players are missing chords and no, all, you know, piano players are clamming all through there, no problem. Drummer misses one beat, you're out of there, pal. So it takes a certain amount of trust and confidence in yourself to know that you're actually, no matter who the band leader is, you're the captain of the ship. And, you know, you got the best seat in the house, as I always like to say. You're on there, you're watching everybody, you know where everybody's going, you know who to pay attention to, who not to have in your mix, you know, if you want it right, you know, the whole thing. It gets kind of complicated, but you really have to just go, okay, I can do this. Okay, I can do it.
It reminds me of a story, Steve. I play in a couple of big bands, and, you know, the saxophones are falling off the front of the risers, right. You know, and the trumpets are way ahead, and the trombones are somewhere in the middle, and the rhythm section, I don't know where they are, you know.
Right.
So whose fault is everything?
It's the drummer's fault.
You know.
Yeah.
So who does the band leader yell at for everything?
The drummer.
Okay, you know what I finally figured out? I went up to him one day, I told him, I said, I got it now. I must be the most important person in the band.
That's right. Exactly. And once you realize that, then it's up to you to take the time, because you can't get defensive, because you know that you're all, it's like being the president of the United States. Somebody's always going to have something to say about you. So, okay, hold on. I know that. I got thick skin. Now, what's the problem? Let me try to fix the problem. Well, I see that the bass player is going to be playing this way the whole night long, okay? He's going to be way behind the beat all night long. So I have to make that adjustment. So I'm going to have to play in the middle or on the top side to get the thing happening where there's a full beat. And it doesn't sound like we're slowing down so much so that not only people stop dancing, but they start leaving, you know, that kind of thing. And then there's the other thing where the person's rushing and they're going to rush all night long. So you have to anchor them down. And then there's the thing where somebody's so precise that it doesn't seem like there's any kind of soul involved at all. Because they used to only use click tracks for commercials and film. And then it became a thing where, okay, we start using them in disco records because we want that kind of thing. And then it escalated to where you couldn't do a record without having a click, you know. But all my favorite records don't have click tracks, and they all have different tempos. They have a tempo for the introduction, and then you slide into a thing for the first verse, and then that first chorus kicks in, and you kick it up a notch, and then you slide back that second verse so that the thing works. And then that second chorus, you can bump it up a notch because people want to get excited. Then you hit that bridge, and then the outro, bam, and you're gone. And so if you listen to a song like a record like Brown Sugar, if you play it back to back, you'll be shocked, because the tempo might start at, 114 or something, and ends up at 130, okay? But it's one of the greatest records ever made. And if it was made at the same tempo, we wouldn't be talking about it right now. And that's the beauty of live performance. That's what I try to do making records. I try to capture live performance. And sure, you can make typewriter music and put it all together. You can manicure everything and get everything to be, you know, how boring. You know, your heart doesn't do that. Why would you want anything else to do that?
Yeah. Amen. Can I give you an amen?
Amen.
Hey, and you mentioned something just earlier, and back to that a minute, about, you know, when you're playing, and I've experienced the same thing. You know, I'm playing, and then I make the mistake of sort of start to listen to myself. What am I doing?
Yeah.
You know, when you this is cool. What am I doing? But that's a dangerous trap, man.
That's a very dangerous thing. And it's not that you're being an egomaniac or anything. You're kind of, I say impressed with what's happening, but you're going, wow, that's kind of cool. I wonder what's happening here. I better not think about that right now. My priority is to keep the thing happening. Okay, it's good. You realize it's good. It's feeling good. It's when it feels good, it's some kind of unconscious thing, and you're just doing it.
The
music took you there. Yeah, exactly.
So it's the right place.
Right, exactly.
But also, you mentioned too, and I want to bring this out, about how, you know, when you're playing live and then you hear the playback, and you go, oh, that's not what I thought I did, or I thought I was more laid back there. And sometimes it happens to me, you know. I think you hear yourself faster than you are all the time.
I don't even know if it's that. I think that it's the way I think it is, it's like you get into a space, you're trying to make something happen, and it's a commitment to something. I know, like, for instance, when I'm playing with Megan, you know, for the longest, you know, when we first started playing together, we were just playing, and it was, you know, on fire. Then we started to evolve and you know, grow as musicians, as you're supposed to do. And we started to alter some things where we try to keep things kind of steady and stuff like that. And her, you know, we're both classical musicians from the start, but then she ended up being in bands that played in CBs a lot and everything, punk oriented, pre-grunge type of things. And that's all about energy and everything. And so then I found myself when we were playing, and then I listened to a tape of us, just the two of us rehearsing. And I had been into that thing where I was like super laid back. Then it wasn't like I was getting deep into the pocket of laid back. I was just too damn slow, you know? So, yeah. You know, it wasn't exciting, you know? So I heard that only in the playback, because when I was doing it, I thought, okay, I'm trying to get the most out of this music, and I'm trying to really, I guess, you know, sometimes you think, yeah, it sounds deeper and more important if you get really laid back, but you can be too laid back sometimes where it just doesn't work for the music. You gotta let the music dictate that, you know? Yeah, so you can have the same thing as when you don't think you're speeding up, and then you listen to it and go, wow. Not that there's anything wrong with speeding up in a way where, you know, accelerando is a musical term that you're supposed to pick up the tempo at a certain time. That's what I think of in outros of some of my favorite records. Like, if you listen to a great Tower of Power record, when they get to the outro, they pick it up. You listen to James Brown, they get to the outro, they pick it up. That's cool. That's nothing to worry about. It's when you don't know you're picking it up. That's when you want to check yourself, you know. The first time I ever heard myself in a control room where I was completely disconnected, it was a very daunting kind of task to figure out how I was going to remedy this disconnection. I was playing something, and I'll never forget it. I was in the studio playing this take. I go in, the drums don't sound anything like I thought the drums sounded like when I was in the room. The whole throw of the beat, because of the sound, made it through the beat completely. Just the balance of the guy's drum mix changed the whole throw of the beat. It sounded like there was another person playing. It didn't even sound like what I was doing, which led me to then figure out, okay, what mics do what. I was fortunate enough to work with the late, great Charlie Conrad, and he showed me about certain miking techniques and certain mics and their relationship to mic pre's, and then figure out, then watching all the great producers. Phil Ramone was very, very generous with his time with me, let me sit in to see a couple things. I was fortunate enough to hang around Stevie Wonder at a certain time in my life to see how he worked in the studio and all of this stuff. And you learn something every day in the studio. I just learned something in the last recording at Royal Studios this past week. Just when I thought I knew whatever, I found out I just learned a whole bunch of stuff that I did not know. And I like to think of myself now as a, you know, since 1988, a person who, like, kind of knows the Mitchell family, and I know, you know, how certain things are done, and I like to walk around feeling like I know some. Man, I found out some stuff this week I had no idea about the different, just different miking techniques that Willie Mitchell came up with to get that sound that he got on Al Jackson and Howard Grimes, that they can't be reproduced. And when you hear that, when you hear a Willie Mitchell production on the radio, on those Al Green records, it sounds as punchy. It sounds punchier today than it did then, because now we can really hear it even better. And up against whoever's record that sounds like this big, tiny, tiny, not that big is better. Just, I'm talking about punch, impact, intensity, and this other thing that's supposed to have that and doesn't. And there were certain, not only miking techniques, but use of compression and mic pre's and the sound of the room, the you know, where the drums were placed and everything that contributed to that. So I learned a lot this week. This has been a very, very blessed and intense week all the way around to record at Royal Studios. And though we miss the great, the one and only Willie Mitchell, Boo Mitchell is here to keep the legacy alive, and he knows a lot of Pop's tricks.
He's actually he's actually in the studio.
Yeah, what? There, oh yeah.
Boo, come on, get up there.
What's up, man?
What's up, brother Jordan?
Boo, do you know that Boo and I? No, you don't know. How would you know this? We have the same birthday, which we found out. Well, it was
when, a couple of years ago.
Yeah.
On my birthday, it was singing happy birthday to me, and right. You called, and you were like, whose birthday is it?
Well, you know, being the nut that I am, I call him up about something, and I said, I hear, happy birthday to you. I said, oh, isn't that sweet? He's singing happy birthday to me with his friends and everything. It was, they were celebrating his birthday.
Hey, we've got a short little video clip that we made this week.
Oh,
Royal.
Cool.
Can we roll that now?
And yeah, awesome.
Take a look at that.
Yeah, I like to see that. I hadn't seen that.
We'll come right back to you guys. And,
all right.
Will he say something?
Mr. Pettit, yeah. What's happening?
I had an appointment with Mr. Jordan.
Down there, make a right. Yeah, check it out. Like in the third verse.
I don't know. I think maybe that little drum thing.
That drum thing was it was okay. So he didn't actually play that.
There was a. I don't think that was humanly possible.
Right. Well. Well. No. I can see him playing that.
You did. I don't.
But
it could have happened.
It could have happened. But if you didn't remember it going down with the take, then he probably Tom probably used
what he could.
Wow. Because I was wondering, I said, wow, that's pretty, that was funky. I mean, in a way where he was like, that, you know, take a chance like that, you know.
I'm your puppet, Dan Monroe. He was like, we did the band track live with the singer.
Since we're doing
jazz, Bobby Grip, I know. Somebody in the group said, well, he needs more.
We're
punching trees. That's a good
song. Yeah.
He said, I don't have any songs. I think Nat sent him upstairs a little demo tape file with a walnut sack recorder, you know.
Eddie.
I'm sure they're the same here in Memphis, you know. They had a lot of songs here a long time, still do.
Right.
You know.
Did you sign that?
Yeah, I got Spooner.
You got Spooner? Oh, okay.
The first one.
Weeks.
Pure sounds.
Willie!
Well, that's what they used, and day one they were fine. You know, it was that sound. But then as time went on, you can't adjust the snares, and because we're not using any bottom mics on this, so which means it's indicative that it gets right. So your radio came. That's the everything has been just
tomorrow 5 o'clock
perfecto, and I think
we're just kicking.
I love this drum here. Yeah. I'll take a picture of this and meet with this drum. All right, we'll go now. These symbols here. Now, this is funny. This is the symbol, obviously, that I got from you. I haven't used any of the symbols that I took from you because these are the symbols from the studio, and I know that Al and Howard played these symbols because they sound exactly like the symbols, and I can't believe they're here. He just broke them out. It was unbelievable.
Yeah.
They sound. Let me get to check
it
out.
Yeah, with the cracked one on top, mind you.
Let's check it out. Hold on. I mean, this is not the right kick, but you can hear. Let me ask you a question. Did you ever get a chance to, do you record Howard Grimes?
Yes.
That must be incredible. What's that like?
It's like going back in time, and it's like being on some of those records. Because when he plays it, just, it's that, you know, it's that sound.
And right.
So it's kind of surreal.
Yeah. you know, he's one of the most underrated, unsung.
Oh, absolutely.
You know, musicians ever to play on as many big records and to have an influence. And then here again is a misconception of, which I'm finding out this week and talking to the Hodges brothers and everything, what Al Jackson played on and what Howard played on.
Right. See, I can hear it.
Right. I now can hear it. Before, I couldn't hear it because, see, Al actually develop the sound with Willie.
Right.
You go with the sound first.
Mm-hmm.
And then, so that's Al's sound. But then Howard, as Willie would say, Howard got that extra little grease.
Yeah.
Then, and Al was, he studied and pretty and very creative, of course.
Right. Al was more finesse. And Pop gave Howard the nickname Bulldog because he said a bulldog just run through stuff, you know, and anything get in his way, just plowing through it.
Wow. And, you know, the funny thing about it is with Al Jackson Jr., you can see him playing with the MGs where he's like a bulldog as well. I mean, you know.
Right.
But you can hear that, especially coming out of that studio when Howard is hitting that groove, and then it's unstoppable.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's wow.
So it was funny, Papa told me there was a couple of records that Al Jackson just didn't have the sound he was looking for.
Right.
And one of those was Love and Happiness.
Right.
And he said, man, he did take after take, and he was like, man, I got to get Howard, because a little too finesse, and Love and Happiness is just gritty and raw and low down, you know?
Right. I remember him telling me that. It's incredible, because you can really, that's the real record that you can hear the difference.
Oh, yeah.
Between the two of them. Yeah, incredible. Wow. So when you were recording with one of Willie's last records was with Solomon Burke, which was Solomon Burke's last record. So what was that experience like? I mean,
oh wow, that was powerful. That was, to me, like that was my graduation session as an engineer.
Right, and sure, right.
Because I always had Papa to lean on. You know, I'd be like doing a mix of something, and everything would sound crazy. I'd be ready to shoot myself and. He's like, Pop, you know, I need help with this mix. And he'd come back there and go click, click, and everything was beautiful. And I'm going, how in the world did you do that? So that session, you know, we got a little more down, and I was like, you know, I started to understand him, you know, because a lot of his techniques was philosophy. You know, he's like, look, man, you know, don't try to please me. He's like, please yourself.
That's the thing about the drumming thing that I was talking about. You know, you can't, you have to, that security in where to put the beat, where you can't depend on somebody else playing a certain way for you to get the groove. You have to have the groove. You have to, and you have to believe in yourself. You have to believe in yourself.
Yeah.
Because, you know, you know, now they have college courses for production and all kinds of, we didn't have that stuff coming. You know, it's like you can get a degree in record making? What are you talking about? Really? Can you do that? So it's like, okay, that's very interesting. But everything that we know about has come from trial and error.
Exactly.
You know? And so, yeah. Wow. So, well, you've done that for us this week, because we had the great Nico Bolas as our engineer, and, you know, who Pops loved him and everything. But what you were doing with Nico, what you were turning Nico on to was unbelievable. So you were doing that thing that Pops showed you, you know? It's incredible, because let me tell you, people, we got the sound this week, man. Woo!
Yeah, it was magical.
It was a real blessing. It was a real, real blessing. Any more questions? Okay.
I'll take some more questions. I'm going to roll.
Okay. Give my regards to everybody over at Royal.
All right. Right.
Okay, thanks for an incredible week.
Yes, sir. Yeah, we got a lot of questions, Steve. Here's one from Guest 57. Hey, Steve, how did you get your snare sound on the track Vultures?
Oh, okay. Well, I worked with a person that I've been working with for 30 years or more. I don't want to give away my age, but his name Artie Smith. And we have been working closely together for, like I said, that amount of time. And he was down here with me in Memphis. And I like to tune my own drums. I like to go after it. I'm very into the tuning of drums. But Artie is a kind of a sound guru. So it's always great, especially in the production capacity, where you can work with somebody who you can describe in some esoteric way, and he understands, and then goes after and gets you close to the sound, or the sound where I don't, it's either he gets me the exact sound, or he gets right there where I just do a little turn of one lug or whatever, or say, no, this is not what I want, you know, but I'm like, I switch out maybe one thing or something, you know, that kind of thing. So, Vultures, it was kind of, I was going after a sound. I was going after an Al Jackson / Howard Grimes sound, Willie Mitchell sound. the tune came about because John Mayer Trio was going on the road, and we didn't have any songs. In fact, we hadn't even rehearsed. They booked the tour, and he didn't have any material or anything. You know, he had the John Mayer catalog, but we're the trio. We got to come up with our own thing. You know what I mean? So we started writing, getting together and jamming and stuff. And one day, I'm talking to Megan about what we should do and what kind of direction, you know, musically. And she suggested, hey, maybe you do something like Take Me to the River. So I said, that's a great idea. That would be awesome. The trio playing Take Me to the River. That's off the chain. Absolutely. So I run it by Pino. He says, bet, Steve, that's a great idea. I said, yeah, well, that's Megan's idea, of course. He said, okay, great. That's an even better idea. Yeah, I said, great. So then we go in and we say, okay, John, man, why don't we play this tune, Take Me to the River, get into the thing, right? Get something going. So we start jamming on it. And I think he was more familiar with the Talking Heads version of Take Me to the River than the Al Green version of Take Me to the River. It's two great versions, you know. But we were talking about the original version. So we start playing around with it and everything like that. And he was like, yo, man, why don't we just come up with our own tune? Get a look, because he came up with this guitar lick. Because we were jamming. We were getting that pocket going. You know, and then he came up with the guitar lick, and he said, look, man, we're at a rehearsal, so we're at SIR. He said, look, just let's record this thing. I'm going to take this thing home and write some words. And the next day, he had Vultures. You know, he had the lyrics. It was like, boom. So the snare drum sound is basically, it's a Brady bird's eye snare drum with wood hoops, Yamaha wood hoops. I've never seen another snare drum like it. It's a deep drum. If we have some tissue and tape in the house, I can kind of simulate that sound with a little doctoring. Because it's really about getting in the ballpark, even though these are not wood rims. I think I can get kind of close with a certain amount of treatment. And then maybe, I don't know what you're listening to, if you're listening on a laptop or what have you, but thank you. I feel like a magician or something. And then you put it into a hat and then a bird comes out.
And do you recommend Charmin or is
there? Yeah, right. Yeah, I used to use maxi pads, okay? Back in the 70s, late 70s. Really? It was a great sound. Okay. All right. Now, of course, you know what Al Jackson used to do? He used to just take his wallet and put it on the snare drum. But you have to make a certain amount of money for that to actually sound good. And my wallet's kind of empty right now, so it won't have the same effect. Okay. To do that, you don't have to have the specific drum. You can get in the ballpark. Just have to tune it down low, make sure the snares aren't too tight, get the right amount of dampening, hit the right part of the drum. It's not a thing where you avoid hitting the rim. You hit the drum right in the middle, and you don't hit too hard. Because if you hit too hard, then you choke it, and that's not the sound. You gotta let the sound breathe. You gotta let the drum breathe. You can hear the softer I play it, it almost sounds louder, you know. It's a beautiful tone. This is an amazing drum. This whole drum set, this is.
Well, so is your internal mix too. I mean, you make that internal mix sound good too, man.
Yeah, you know, you gotta see a lot of great records, you know, were made like with like two mics, you know, like two tracks. So everybody was always mixing themselves. The horn section would mix themselves, you know, the drums, you know, you get your internal mix, like you said, you know. You never play this too loud and everything. You want the drums. That's why, I'm sorry to chop off my own sentences, but, you know, drums were made to resonate together. So when people started choking things off, they stop the sound of the kit. And of course, when you make drums with really thick shells, then they really don't ring together. It's the lighter shell that gets all the drums to ring together to get the beautiful tone of the entire kit. They sing together, exactly. And that's the deal. That's why a kit like this sounds so incredible, you know, without doing very much.
Hey, I got a question, Sean from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Can you tell us about your new 22-inch Paiste 20 Masters Dark Ride?
Let's see, what can I say? Well, Paiste is making a really great, their last batch coming out of their last R&D session was unbelievable. They have about four different lines of cymbals that are just incredible. And I took my K Zildjian cymbal that was Elvin Jones' cymbal, Don Bennett in Washington, Seattle, Washington has the Elvin Jones collection of drums, and I bought a cymbal from him, and it, you know, one of Elvin's cymbals, and I brought it over to AB against these new Paiste cymbals, and there was a rumor going around that they were maybe going to discontinue the traditionals, and I panicked, and I was like, what are you talking about? These are my cymbals. I said, no, but we got some new stuff coming, and I think the earlier version of the 20s, I guess, before, like, I wasn't too crazy about. And then they came out with this new version, and they're great. And they have like three other lines that I'm. They have a new 602, and they have some two other lines that I'm not versed on what they are, but they may be in the 20 family. But they are very musical, and they give you something different than the trads. They're a little brighter than the trads with certain things, that so it translates on modern records. It's a worthwhile investment.
Steve, I got a really interesting question here. This is from Florian Malot. Are you not afraid that we have passed the golden age of music? What's your opinion on the formatted music we have today?
Well, I just try to, anytime I can, I try to make recordings the way I feel comfortable making them. And that's with other players playing at the same time, which I think is key to getting a performance. With shrinking budgets and stuff like that, you can't do what you used to do all the time, but at least I try to get the tracks where their performance is, and then if you have to overdub whatever element afterwards because you couldn't all be there at the same time, or the limitations of the studio or whatever, that's one thing. But I try to get the core of the track together for it to be a performance, so that even if it's not a live vocal taking place, the vocalist, if it is a, you know, provided it's vocal music, can react to a performance and get a great performance. One great performance inspires another great performance.
Hey man, I wish I could pronounce all these names, but I just can I spell another name for you, Steve?
Sure.
This is from Frankfurt, Germany. Yavuz, Y-A-V-U-Z.
Y-A, what?
V-U-Z.
Oh, yeah. Yavuz.
Yavuz, maybe yeah. That's close. Okay. We apologize if it's not. But the question is, hello from Frankfurt, Germany. I was wanting to know about the idea behind the Yamaha Club Custom drums. They like the sound and quality of those, that kit.
That kit, my first tour with the Verbs was in Japan, and I was talking to Yamaha about making a kit that was a small kit that would work well with the sound of our band. We wanted a smaller combo sounding thing. That's the thing Megan and I have when we play together. It's kind of like a little machine chugging away, and big drums don't do it. Thick shells don't do it. So there was, going back to my childhood, I used to always see these drums in school that Ludwig would make for the Board of Education, and they were always like the low-line drums, right? Now they're the most coveted drums out there, you know, these six lug kind of, you know, brown painted, you know, that I have one of those six lug brown Board of Education drums. I use that on the Keith Richards album, Talk Is Cheap. I use that on the song Make No Mistake, which is the tune that we took down to Royal for Willie to put the horns on. It was my introduction to Willie Mitchell in person. Well, that was one of the drums, right? So I thought to myself, well, what? So that's basically the deal. Cheap wood and thin ply, less metal on the drums, great sound. So I asked Takashi Hagiwara, who had just left Yamaha, and some other people that were replacing him, and said, what? And Azo, who, Azo Hokata, who was at Sakai Rhythm, who makes drums for Yamaha, in addition to the great Sakai drum line that they're making now. I said, I'd like to kind of do what was done in the States, where back in the day, they'd just make low, not cheap, just inexpensive. There's a difference between cheap and inexpensive. Affordable instruments for kids to learn on, but that sounded good. What kind of wood is that? Well, what, so I asked them specifically, what wood do you use when you make drums for children in school? And they told me what the wood was. So I said, like a drum set made out of that wood. And a certain ply, I just wanted to be three ply or whatever. And I said that, and as it turns out, they couldn't make a three ply kit. So I ended up being four ply. I said, okay, that's fine. And it developed from there. Okay, what finish do you want? Well, I don't want it, here again, inspired by a late 60s thing. I wanted a swirl, but I didn't want a wrap. I said, can we get a paint going? So they developed a paint and a paint wrap. It was not a rap. I mean, it's just the drum is painted. That's the sound of the drum. It's a paint. And so I was like, wow, okay, that's great. And they came up with it. It was just gorgeous. So that kit was specifically for the Verbs. And they couldn't make the bearing edges where I wanted because the machinery, they just didn't have that. So we got as close to what I requested. And that's basically how the kit came about. And then then they called me and said, yeah, we're coming out with a new club custom kit. I said, oh, really? Yeah, and it's inspired by you. Do you want to do something? I said, oh, really? Yeah, so that's how the kit came about. And it's a very versatile kit. You can get a lot out of it. I've used it several times. I'll be using it on the Emmys next week or in 2 weeks. And it really sings, you know, but it's not too big. Like I said, the drums resonate. And, you know, they're excellent. They're really good drums.
The sound killer today here in the studio.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And this is the first time I played one that didn't have the paint. This is the first time I've used, and they sound great. Yeah.
Okay, this is from Guest 191. Can you give me some pros and cons on resonant bass drum heads with and without holes, either in a big venue or in a studio?
Well, here again, the music dictates what you do in regards to that. If you're doing like a 70s kind of sounding thing, like what we're doing at Royal with the Al Jackson, Howard Grimes, Willie Mitchell combination, then you don't even have a front head. You know, there's a certain part of time in the 70s and late 60s, early 70s, where you took the front head off and then you got the mic closer and then you do a certain amount of dampening and packing to get a certain sound to give you impact. Now, of course, in some of my favorite records ever made, you have both heads on. So, like, if you're doing, like, a Motown thing. Double head thing to give you a note. You know, you can't do that with a dead kick drum. You need the drums ringing, you know. You know, going to a go-go, all that stuff, it's all the drums have notes, you know, and shotgun even. You can't do with a dead kick. It doesn't work. Now,
singing again. There's a singing again.
Yeah. I sing a lot when I play. Yeah. That's part of the thing that gets me through the song, you know. Hopefully, mics don't pick it up too much, and they go, "Wait, hey, that lead singer is not too good." So the music dictates what you do with your kick drum.
Okay, here's a Glasgow, Scotland. Keir Fletcher, is there a particular way you decide what groove fits a particular song? For example, do you listen to the bass line or the melody, or is it just the feeling of the song?
It's the feeling of the song, the melody, it depends on what the process is. Like if the artist is producing or the producer wants a certain thing, then I try to capture what they're requesting. If I'm producing and I have an idea of what I think could make the song work with a feel, then I will suggest that to the artist and then we'll talk about it and maybe approach it. For instance, this week with Boz Skaggs, we had a couple of instances where we started out going in one way and then he requested the track be a little bit more still. And it was a great suggestion because it brought more space for him to sing. And it changed the mood of the track. And it was more intense than what we thought we were going after with a little bit more rhythm. Actually taking some of the rhythm out made the music more intense because there was more space. And then there was more room for him to interpret with his vocal.
How did you do that? Did you go from, like, say, eighths on the hat to quarters, or how did you make?
Well, for instance, like there was a tune called, an old Steely Dan tune that we just recorded called Pearl of the Quarter. And at first, it started out like, and it was grooving and everybody was, yeah, happy and everything, but that's not really the lyric. That's not why he wanted to do the song. He said, can we just straighten it out, make it a little bit, give some air, a little bit more still, so I can interpret the song a certain way, the way I was hearing it. Because that's kind of jolly, even though I felt the track was great. Willie Weeks was, you know, everybody, Ray Parker, we were getting down, you know, it was like, whoa, look out, Spooner, Charles Hodges, we were, wow, you know. But that wasn't right for the song. So it ended up being, you know, still grooving. Actually, that feels better. More room for the vocal. And it gave us this kind of intent, like, let's just go like this. It's almost like a heartbeat. And then you start to go with the lyric. That kind of thing. And it was like, oh yeah, that's good for the vocal. Oh yeah, oh, it's feeling good. Then we all got into it. And then, you know, the thing came out amazing. It just came out really great.
Cool.
Yeah.
Cool. Well, we got to wrap it up here, Steve, but we got one more question. And I think this is something that would be important to a lot of people. This is from guest 778. Hello from Bavaria, Germany.
Right on.
What is your advice for young drummers?
Listen to as much music as possible. Be open to suggestions. Never say, no, it's got to be this way. It's got to be open, willing to communicate, willing to try different things. You can develop your opinions about stuff, but you don't want to force your opinions on other people. You want to be open to different ways of thinking about things. And I would listen to as much music as humanly possible. Also, try to seek out as much as you can. You know, a lot of people these days, if they're not getting paid to go into the studio, then they think they're getting ripped off. So they don't want to go in the studio, or they want to do this, because there's always something to learn. I used to do tons of sessions for nothing, just so I could be in the studio. You can't pay for that kind of education, you know? I would do as much as possible to learn about what you're trying to do. I mean, even if you're not getting paid for something, or you think you're getting underpaid and so you don't want to do it, no, go in, take the date. Perform, always do your best job, no matter what, obviously. That goes without saying. But while you're there, you check out the console. Say, what kind of console is this? Oh, what does that compressor do? What is that? You know, there's got to be a perk for you to do this thing. The perk is you can learn about the stuff that you're working with. You don't have to confine yourself to the drum booth or whatever. Obviously, you're there to do a job, and you want to do your best job, so you want to take care of that business first. Do I have a good sound? Am I locking in with the thing? But then on the playback, when you're in the control room, you take a look at what kind of gear they have. What does that do? What does this do? You learn as much as you possibly can, if this is the career that you choose. That would be my advice.
Well, Steve, thank you so much. It's been fantastic today, man. It's been a real honor for to have you here with us today. And I think everybody around the world has learned some things about Steve Jordan. That's something I wanted to do for a long time. You know, I contacted you earlier in the year and I said, I want this to be about what you are.
Well, thank you for the opportunity, Jim. And thanks for having this store. I can't overemphasize what this drum shop means for not just drummers, but musicians. We need people like you, more people like you, that care about the instruments that are being played and have been played, so that it keeps our craft alive and thriving. Like I said, there are only a handful of people who do this, and you're second to none in what you have in this store, and especially here in Memphis, where this town's musical legacy is so important and so deep. And for you to stay here to do it, as opposed to moving somewhere else to do this, where you might even make more money or whatever, I don't know. Because quite frankly, I don't know how you're doing it. I mean, it's unbelievable to have this kind of store in a town that actually, really, in a lot of ways, has not moved from certain things since the assassination of Martin Luther King. We've been stuck in certain things, and you are going forward. Like the president of the United States wants to move forward, well, you're moving forward, you know? And that's it. Now we just got to re-elect Barack Obama, and we could be cool.
Hey, let's. I got a favor to ask you, man. Let's okay. go. You mentioned what was it? Take Me to the River.
Yeah.
Let's go out. Let me play that, kid.
Oh,
and you play yours.
Okay.
And we'll go out on that.
All right, you got it. You got it.
Now get the start.
Okay. Yeah. Definitely, because you got the sound. Thank you very much. Awesome.